in our particular communities. And that it's not really a new initiative because these are the things that we every day get up in the morning to do, to foster economic development in our communities and all segments of our community. And as a company, we have also created an infrastructure to allow for that. Reverend Sadler would attest that in those morning breakfasts for the Christian Business League, I have with me many members of community development, as well as our entire bank, that are a part of our African American Employee Business Resource Group. That has been created years ago to give African American employees an opportunity to be heard and to be valued, as well as to be engaged, but also to gain a better understanding of our customers so that we can better serve them and to drive business. One other thing, and I would just want to make reference to, because it goes back to February prior to the George Floyd situation, where our CEO had the forethought of bringing together over 100 African American senior leaders all in one room and to challenge us to be that thought leader, to be that driver, and to be that connector to executive leadership to once again to drive this particular initiative. So there's a strong level of accountability. And just quickly, when I think of the three pillars, and once again, we're going to be building this out as we go, with the thought that in January of 2021, we'll be ready to go. The three pillars will be education, economic empowerment, and business ownership and growth. So once again, we will continue to build that out. We are working right now with national leaders that will be partners, because it will all be about partnerships. So we're connecting with our national leaders. We're working right now with our regional leaders, and that we will also be able to create these valuable partnerships at the local level, like the Christian Business League and municipalities like the City of Cleveland and Warrensville Heights, which gives me a great segue to introduce our speaker for today, the Honorable Brad Sellers, Mayor Brad Sellers. Brad Sellers is the city's seventh mayor and the first Native resident of Warrensville Heights to be elected to office. So he knows the community. He has a passion for the growth of the community, and it goes without saying that he is invested in the community. He succeeded our beloved Congresswoman Fudge, who was the previous mayor, as he worked alongside her as a director of economic development. Under Mayor Sellers' tenure, he saw the creation of a 9 million branch of the Cuyahoga County Library. He's actively involved in attracting new businesses in the area of Harvard Park commercial development, which attracted national retailers such as Marriott Hotel, Bed Bath & Beyond, Marshall's, Buffalo Wild Wings, and Panera Bread, as well as housing projects like the Chateau of Emery Woods and Cinema Park. And I have his full bio here, so I'm not going to go through the entire bio, but as I look at his bio, there are a few phrases, a few statements that come across very clear, such as a vision for the city, exceptional service, preserving great neighborhoods, creating opportunities for children, and expanding the job creation agenda. He is a true visionary leader. Mayor Sellers attended the Ohio State University and spent 15 years playing professional basketball in the NBA. And collectively, and Mayor, with all honor, I would refer to him as a big baller shot caller because of his hard work and his leadership throughout his professional business career and his professional sports career. And on top of that, he's a proud father of four beautiful daughters. So please join me in welcoming the Honorable Mayor Brad Sellers.
economic climate in Warrensville Heights has been heating up for a while now. You can see it through growth with our existing partners and the development of new ones. We now have Amazon located just over our border, and we feature very affordable commercial property within our city limits. We're truly a prime hub of activity on Cleveland's thriving east side. Honestly, Warrensville Heights has never looked better, but I want you to see it for yourself.
First of all, to my friend Michael Taylor, to Pastor Sadler, to everyone who is tuning in to the Masterclass series, it is my pleasure to be here and participate in the Masterclass session tonight. And let me just say this, Mike Taylor, it is with people like you who understand the complexities of this world, understand equal opportunity for all folks like you that have been partners with the city of Warrensville Heights for a long time, trying to make economic empowerment an opportunity, along with trying to make it just a place that we can call a great place to call home. And so it's my pleasure to be here. I look forward to this evening. I think that we're going to have some fun. We're going to enjoy some open conversation, and I am just excited. I've been excited since I was offered the opportunity to participate in it, and I'm looking forward to tonight. And again, to you, Mike Taylor, thank you for everything you've done.
Thank you so much, Mayor Sellers. We are excited to have you as our inaugural masterclass leader tonight. We're excited because you have brought so much to this community as a native son of Warrensville Heights, Ohio, and you have made yourself and your city proud because of the commitment that you have had to uplifting and building this community. And so we're so grateful for the opportunity to have you with us this evening. I want to begin by asking you to just talk a little bit about your journey. Your journey from being a young kid who grew up on McCann Street in Warrensville Heights, Ohio, who made his way to the NBA and then achieved in business, in the business world, and then decided to step into the political realm. How did you make this journey, and what was it like for you, and what inspired all of that? Because that took a whole lot for you to make that journey.
Yeah, well, Pastor, I appreciate the question. And let me say, for me, I'm going to give you the total route. The route, I grew up and I was born in Cleveland, and my family, we lived in Mount Pleasant. And in 1970, my parents, well, my father was a postal worker and my mother worked for the VA, were chasing the American dream for their two sons. And they felt like the education opportunity belonged, a better opportunity for us in the suburbs. And so I was 9 or 10 years old. I had no idea that when they said we were moving to Warrensville Heights. So when we moved to Warrensville Heights, I lived off of Kinsman. And Warrensville Heights in 1970 seemed like, and I tell you, it seemed like 50 miles, 100 miles from Mount Pleasant. And actually, as I'm older now, it's really like a 9 or 10 minute drive, but it seemed like 50 miles. And so when I got out here, my parents, they were just hardworking folks. And, you know, they just wanted a good education opportunity for us and for my brother and I. And so we got out here and we got acclimated to suburban living, which was different than living in Mount Pleasant. It was totally different than living out here. There, people had, it was still integrated at the time. There was a integration period of a number of African-American and minorities moving to Warrensville Heights. Warrensville Heights actually was one of the first suburban communities to really allow integration. It was, the three places were Shaker Heights, Warrensville Heights, and East Cleveland, right? And that's where it really began in that time. And so when we got out here, it was maybe 70% white, 30% black. And so when we moved out here, my parents, and let me correct that, Pastor, my mother, because my mother was the visionary. She was the one who was like, it's time to go, right? Now my father was like, I'm not going anywhere. We're staying right here on 138th here. That's where we're staying. And she was like, well, you can stay if you want to. We're going to go out here and look to buy a house. So when they finally found a house, they bought the house. My father wouldn't leave Mount Pleasant for a year. It took us a year to move in here, right? Now I'm 10. I don't understand what's really going on. But my mother was chasing the dream. My father always believed in higher education, getting it done. And he didn't see the need to forecast forward to see where we were going. And so when we got out to Warrensville, it was a whole different standard about expectations, a family counseling us about expectations, how to integrate, how to make things happen, and then prove to folks that you could deliver on a high level, right? So they held us accountable for homework, scholastically, held us accountable for care around the house, upkeep of the house. If we played in sports, held us accountable to make sure you weren't a quitter, that you at least saw it through, whether you had success in it or not. And that's where some of that foundation was born. And so as Warrensville went through the migration period and more white people moved out and more blacks moved in, pretty much settled into the Warrensville that I know today. But still in that transition, the parents who now are the seniors here in this community who really run this town. I don't run the town. They just have me just navigate through the waters, right? But they give me the instructions and say, this is what I want you to do, right? This is what we put you here to do. They're the one that trained myself and a lot of my peers are out here doing the things that we're doing now to the point where you got to deliver, be about your word. And guess what? As you make your way up the ladder, if you have success, you come back and you reach back. You reach back and make sure that you open the doors for other people. So my journey from Warrensville to Heights High School off McCann to Ohio State University, was all a part of being acclimated to a good sports program out here in Warrensville. And so I just was blessed, because fast is a blessing, right? And the 300 people, it was 375 people in the NBA when I was playing, right? And so it wasn't an easy path to get to. And so I was blessed to be able to just share a small part of my life with that. And in that, the blessing was not so much in the ability just to play there, but the exposure to other things, other communities, different places around the country, plant chances to travel the world, some economic empowerment. So I had a taste of what it could be to be at the other end of the spectrum. And then so when I retired, I was in 2000, where a lot of players, former athletes, they get lost, right? They don't know how to make the transition. And I don't say I was more prepped than anybody else. I had another blessing. Marsha Fudge, who's the congresswoman for the district here and the former mayor of this city, was looking for somebody to head up her economic development. And she offered me an opportunity. This was 5 months into my retirement. So I had no idea that I was coming here to do any political. That was never on my to-do list, right? But I was blessed because my parents were community activist people, and they knew everybody, and they would drag me to the meetings as a kid. As a kid, I would sit in the back of the room and say, I don't even want to go to this meeting. Why do I have to sit here in this meeting? But being in the room, I would hear the conversations that the adults were actually having about So the journey is what it's about, right? And so I was able to be blessed and understand that. And Marsha actually gave me an opportunity to come back in here and hear. I was able to understand the complete 360 of the mission, right? You're supposed to touch all of the circle, right? So everybody's supposed to get a shot at this. And so, but somebody has to stand here and work hard to try to make sure that we have a chance to do things for other people. So I'm going into my ninth year, so I must be not half bad.
that's a great story, and the journey has had a lot of twists and turns, and it's always been, it seems, an uphill journey, not a journey ever going downward, but continuing to climb higher and higher and higher, and moving from one great experience, from one great challenge to another. So I'd ask you a question. In that regard, and that is, so what makes you wake up every morning and want to build Warrensville Heights, Ohio, bigger than what it is now? What, you know, I have to be honest, I've known a lot of mayors in my time. I've lived in a lot of different cities and had the opportunity of working with a number of big city mayors. And I've known mayors who have not had the kind of passion that you have for building your city, for economic development, for advancing the city. And your passion for this never seems to end. You've been there 9 years, you said. And so, but it seems like, you know, every time you and I talk, and we talk a lot, every time you and I talk, you've got a new vision for the city of Warrensville Heights, Ohio. And so what drives you? What wakes you up in the morning and says, I want to do this, or I want to do that, or I want to try this, something that no one else who led Warrensville before ever tried?
Well, it's a great question. Let me say that I'm driven by a couple principles here to answer your question. One is, when you are a high-talented athlete, there's a mindset here that the words I always say was, to be a high talent athlete, you're in an arena with a bunch of high talent athletes. The question is, are you going to get outworked by anybody? That means, when I say outworked, are you going to put into your craft what's necessary to make yourself better, and at least keep yourself at a level that can compete at a high level? So I have an inherent drive inside of myself to say that I want to perform at a certain level, period. Right. And I use that every stop I go. I don't care if it was the classroom. I don't care if it was on the court. I don't care if it's in this mayoral arena. I don't care if it's the development arena. You're not going to outwork me. That's not going to happen. Right. Because that's the only thing that keeps me honest about myself. Because there was a saying, Pastor, Michael Jordan told me a long time ago, mm-hmm. 22, that I'll never forgot. And let me tell you what that is. He said, you know, you're only good as your last game. I said, what does that mean? He said, think about it. You're only good as your last game. So if you had 2 points in the game, you're probably a bum. But if you had 25, you're pretty good. But in saying that, we play every other day. So the new game comes every day, right? So that means you better be on your craft here, because if you're not on your craft, there's a kid from Dubuque, Iowa, probably coming in here, and he's hungry too. He got cousins and family and brothers and sisters to feed too. So it keeps me honest. The other thing is that drives me out here is I've never been one to be pigeonholed in a box. I'm not a one-dimensional guy, right? Mm-hmm. I'm simplistic, but I'm not a one-dimensional person, right? And when people start putting labels on people about what you can do, and I'm talking about as Black folks, mm-hmm. right? We can only do so much. Who said that? I didn't say that. I don't subscribe to that theory. I said, you show me the rules to the game, I'll beat you at your own game. Yes, I will. And you give me the tools that you have, I'm really going to beat you at your own game, right? And it's not my victory. And the job that I'm doing now is the victory for the people that I represent here, right? And so I'm driven by that. I'm driven by to prove folks that we too can compete at a high level, right? I can tell you, I won't mention people's name, but there's some big-time developers in Cleveland proper, right? Mm-hmm. When we were trying to spring this place up to put it probably back up to be on its feet, do you know, and some of them here, I'm going to be honest with you, some of them came from our own community. And some of the things they told me when I was doing this job, they're like, I don't know why you're wasting all your time here, because that thing is, that's not going to happen out there. It's just not going to happen. Mm-hmm. You're not going to land such and such company or this, that, and the other. You're not going to be able to build any houses out there. I'm like, oh, really? Why is that? Because if it was going to happen, it would already happen. And so I was like, I don't subscribe to that. I said, now my mission is I'm about to beat you at your own game here, because I'm just going to prove to you that we can do this. And in that, the thing that drives me is that I know when you have success, people will come back to you on the backside. They see what you're doing, and mm-hmm. it should inspire other people to get better. Mm-hmm. Right. So that's pretty much, those are the things that keep me going. And the last thing is, I'm always thinking about my mother and father who passed away in the 90s, right? I'm always thinking about, would they be proud of me for what I'm doing? Would they want me to do it this way? And so that's the internal torch I carry.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it goes without saying that your mother and father are proud of you, as all of us are proud of you for the accomplishments that you've made and what it has done to help so many people in the city of Warrensville Heights, and not just in Warrensville Heights, but just throughout the greater Cleveland area. You know, you're a dad, you have four girls, and you're the mayor of a city that is on the grow, that is growing economically, that is growing numerically. You're in the process of building new homes in the city of Warrensville, probably something that had not been done, I would wager, in many, many years before you came. And how do you balance fatherhood and building the city of Warrensville as the mayor? How do you balance those two things and maintain a kind of a healthy tension between the two things that are most important to you in your life?
Well, Pastor, you're speaking as a person that has good balance in his life. And I'm going to tell you that it was a learned piece. When I first started here, I tell you, I didn't have that balance. Mm-hmm. I was so used to playing ball all day and doing what I had to do. And you it's different here because you have to balance your life here. It's just like you got to have a little bit of everything. You can't be all one-dimensional here. And when I first started, I was just dripping on strictly one dimension. We're going to build some things. We're going to make this place great. We're going to do a whole bunch of things. We don't have a whole lot of time to do it, right? And that's what I use to push me every day, right? And so as my kids were little, I would miss little things like little games and little plays and recitals, right? Because I had to go to this meeting trying to get this deal and that deal. And as I got older, some of the folks I worked around who were just seasoned, they were like, listen, you got to level this out here. And so you find a balance. But I really still couldn't hear it, right? Even though I felt like I was giving everybody quality time.
Okay.
But quality time is different, right? And so it wasn't until my third oldest daughter was like, Dad, I had a track meet.
Okay.
And she came to talk to me.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, Dad, you weren't there. And she started crying.
Mm-hmm.
I said, Shay, that bothered you? I mean, you see me every day. I mean, that bothered you? She's like, yeah, it bothered me. And she, I mean, so we had a long, and at that point, Pastor,
mm-hmm.
and then she had to be 7 at that time, right? 8. At that point, I said, I'm going about this all wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to hit this during these hours, right? Hard as I can.
Okay.
And then when it comes to their time, they're going to get their time. Yes, they are. I'm not going to miss a thing. Since that time, Pastor, I haven't missed anybody's event.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, as a proponent here, I tell my own staff, I got 200 people that work for me, right?
Okay.
If your kid has an event, right, or something that you should go to that requires you to leave here a little early, you're going to punch out of here today. Yes, you are.
Mm-hmm.
Because I believe in family, right? I believe in taking care of your people, right? And so once I learned it, really learned it, right, that's what I make sure that I get this balance. So now I got work. I've got my sports thing I do on the side. I've got my kids thing. I live through that and the events that they do. My grandson does his thing. And then I live through this as well. Trying to be healthy and fit, right? That's where you and I used to talk at the fitness spot every night about trying to stay healthy and making sure your mind stayed right. And so it has been a long journey for me. And I wouldn't have missed a day of it, right? Because every day was a lesson. And I used that lesson to be better on the next day.
Okay. Now, you know, I know about your drive because, as many people probably don't even think about going to the gym at 11 o'clock at night. But I've been at the gym at 11 o'clock at night. I'm packing my stuff, getting ready to go home. Mayor Sellers is coming in the door, full of energy, ready to work out at 11 o'clock at night because he's driven. And, you know, I realized when I was doing my research in preparation for this time that we're spending together, I went back and looked at some old Chicago Bulls video. And I saw a game that you were playing where I was actually in the audience at Old Chicago Stadium.
No.
Yes, I found it. My wife and I and some friends got some tickets. We went to see the Bulls play and you were there. I was amazed. We talked about this and I never thought I had ever seen you play. But there you were. There you were. So this is like kind of full circle, you know,
yes, it is.
To see that, you know, you were a young man. We were both young men.
Young, I had no idea what the world had in store for me.
Exactly. You were filled with drive then and you're still filled with drive now. And that, I think that is what makes you unique. That's what sets you apart from perhaps other folk who have found their way to politics. Just an aside kind of a question on that subject. Did you ever think that you would become the mayor of your hometown, Warrensville Heights, Ohio?
Pastor, to be honest, I did not at all. Now, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to be 100% honest with you. This was not in my picture, right? I was like, because I live with parents who were community activists, people who were always on the go here, trying to make sure the thing ran right with the schools and everything else, right? And so, yeah, I saw it. I knew I wanted to do some things after basketball, but politics was not one of them. But I will tell you this, when my mother passed away, just days before the service, one of her good friends here came to me and said, listen, what are you going to do? What do you mean, mm-hmm. what am I going to do? Mm-hmm. Like, your mother is gone now, but what are you going to do? I said, what do you mean, what am I going to do? She went on to say this. We've got plans for you. Your mother and I had plans for you. What kind of plans do you have for me? Right. Mm-hmm. And that was Dorothy Blackman. I was like, she was like, no, you're going to run this place. Yes, you are.
Wow.
And I was like, so they had talked about this eons ago.
Wow.
Yes, they had. And I was like, I stayed there with my mouth open. I'm like, what?
Okay. Okay.
And it still took me some years to even realize that was my journey. But
right.
But when I first heard it, because this was the 90s, I didn't retire in 2000, so I wasn't really mm-hmm. listening to it, but mm-hmm. I heard it. And now I reflect back on it, I'm like, they were plotting things for the betterment of not me,
okay,
for the group, because they had laid they were part of a group that laid the groundwork out here in Warrensville,
right,
and made sure they were sentries at the gate.
Right.
They were like, we're getting older now. We're going to need new sentries at the gate. You're going to be one of the sentries.
Amen. I don't know if you remember a conversation that you and I and my son Paul had at Congresswoman Stephanie Tubbs Jones' funeral. We were at the repast after the funeral, and we were talking, and my son and I had put our heads together and decided that you needed to be the mayor of Warrensville Heights, Ohio. And we said, just quite frankly, we said, Brad, you need to run for mayor. This is how this is going to go. Mrs. Fudge is going to Congress. So
right.
Marsha Fudge is going to be our next congresswoman, and she is. And you're going to be the mayor of Warrensville Heights, Ohio.
So I remember you saying that.
Yes, I guess we must have been in the, I must have heard in the spirit from the good folks who were surrounding you, your mother and father, and all the good folks of Warrensville who were surrounding you and giving you that kind of encouragement and guidance. You know, people see things in you that sometimes you don't see in yourself. Mm-hmm. And I think it was just to me, to I'm sure your parents and to the elders who are around you, I think it was obvious that what they had instilled in you was for the purpose of your taking on the leadership of the community, and that was your destiny. And sometimes people can see your destiny when you can't see it yourself. You know, one of the things that you said to me when we talked last week was that you listened to, and I think this is a tribute to you. You said you listen to the elders and what the elders of the community have to say. And I think for far too many folks today, they discount what the elders have to say. And they're trying to be relevant, they miss out on the wisdom that the elders have. Now, what role would you say, just based on just what you just shared with us, what role would you say that the wisdom of the elders has played in the moves and the steps that you have taken in your life, in particular as mayor of Warrensville Heights?
Well, I think they've played a great role. Let me tell you why, because, and I'll relate a lot of things I've talked to, because it to me, it's all based in athletics. I mean, there's core, learning to work with people, understanding where people come from, figuring mm-hmm. out how to get the most out of them. But I will tell you, you know, I was blessed in that Chicago team. I had some older guys on the team, right?
Yeah.
And I came out of Ohio State, I didn't know nothing about nothing. I didn't know about $2, $3, $4, right? Buying a house, what do you mean buying a house? You know, I didn't come from that type setup, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so the older guys, I learned to listen to the older guys that were logical, been at the craft for a while, and understood mm-hmm. the long-range mission, right? And I was able to sit down. When I didn't first came in, I didn't understand how it was put together, but then I understand to listen, right? And it goes back to they have a perspective. They've paid dues. They may see some things that I don't see, right? And you can learn a lot from that. Now, you can take that information and put your knowledge on top of that and shape it,
right?
So that it's beneficial to the group, right? And mm-hmm. so when I'm back here, I lean on the senior community heavily because they have paid the dues. They're the ones that opened the door for me and my peers, right?
Mm-hmm.
Without them coming here, fighting the fight to make sure we could all reside out here and make sure the education system was produced at a high level. If we didn't have that, I don't know where I would be, right? So I owe a debt of gratitude to them, right? So I don't discount them at all. I try to make sure that they're well taken care of. I was at a funeral today.
Okay.
I was at a funeral today, and the resident, her husband had just passed, and I believe in 6 degrees of separation, right? And so she mm-hmm. tells me, this is at the funeral, right? They hadn't started the service yet, but it was about to start. And she's a member of our senior club out here. There's about 150 people that belong to the senior club. It was active, very active group. And we had to stop the meetings because of COVID-19, right? Okay. Well, she came to me today. She said, I don't care what it is. Get those meetings started back up. We need to see one another. And she wasn't talking about herself and me and her. She's mm-hmm. talking about that group has been locked away in their homes trying to be safe, but okay. now they need the camaraderie, right? Because they're losing people, right? Mm-hmm. And so now I have to go back and take that and figure out how we can achieve it in a safe manner. We'll start out with some Zoom meetings and then try to transition back to some open meetings mm-hmm. Once I can perfect the environment. But I tell you what, because they have paid the dues, Pastor, and when people pay the dues, you got to respect the dues that people pay. Mm-hmm. You can't discount them.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, it's interesting. And as you talked, I see some similarities between what it's like to be a pastor and what it's like to be a mayor. Just like pastors have constituents for whom they're responsible and for whose health and well-being they have concern and responsibility. And as a mayor, you have the same kind of responsibility for the folks in your community. And I see that you're passionate about responding to the needs that you see and addressing the concerns that come before you. And I think that's a great thing. Well, we want to give those who are participants, those who have joined us tonight for this masterclass, an opportunity to ask some questions. And so we're grateful for all of those who are joining with us. We have, there's 32 plus people who are watching you tonight, who are listening to your wisdom. So we want to give all of them an opportunity, if they have a question, that they can write their question right into the Q&A that's a part of the Zoom presentation. But I have a question actually already that has come from a participant in Washington, D.C. This comes from Wes in Washington, D.C. And Wes would like to know, could you share some stories or a story that describes your experience and what you learned in economic development, specifically in Warrensville?
Well, let me think of one that I have learned. One I learned from the bat was you only get out of it what you put in, right? And in economic development, things don't happen at a blink of an eye. You have to just sometimes just stay with it. Keep working it. Even when something looks like it's not going to materialize and you feel like you have a good idea, but your idea has to be based in at least the due diligence work behind it, that it can be something that's achievable, right? And one of the things I learned here is you're up against a lot of competition. So against the competition, because it's a very competitive world and field, but you have to believe in yourself, believe in the product, believe in the thing that you're pitching, so that when you engage with other people, you can pass that on them and they can get that flavor and that vibe from you, right? At the end of the day, you have to be able to be about your business too, to be able to be on the part of the deliverables, right? Do you know what the money side of the deal looks like? Do you understand what the pinch points are for that particular developer? Do you understand what the pinch points for the community are? And you have to mesh those two worlds together. I believe in one thing. I believe in like a triangle theory. It's like Bull's triangle offense. Like at each point of the triangle, when we're doing a deal, everybody's got to feel like they were a participant and came out of the deal together. When you got three points of the triangle together and everybody feels like that, then you have the impetus for a great deal. If you only got 2 points or 1 point, it's one side or two sided, then one side is going to get slighted and it's going to get shaky on you, right? Yeah. And it, for me, in economic development, it's always about making sure that when we do things, that folks that live here have an opportunity to participate or are going to benefit from it in some shape, form, or fashion.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We have a question from a basketball fan from Louisiana who says, can you tell us what similarities you see in the skill set needed to be a professional athlete and a successful politician? And what have you done to craft those skills?
Well, I'll say this, and I mentioned it earlier. It really is, let me tell you something, I'm not doing anything different than I did in the locker room. See, okay. when you're in a team environment, you got to know a couple things. Who the players in the room are, what pecking orders out here, who's on the totem pole and where you fit on that totem pole, and then learning to navigate and work with others as you build yourself in the direction that you want to go, right? Because there's no politician or athlete out here doing it by themselves. If you think they're doing it by themselves, it's ridiculous, right? Because it's not going to happen. You need to be able to leverage your responsibilities and your personality and your thinking and know how to work with other folks and bring those worlds together. So it really is about teamwork all the time. And in politics, it's like sports to this degree, right? So if you think of my position as mayor, I would be the captain of the team, right? So as the captain of the team, I have others behind me that look to the captain to make sure the captain's going to do what's necessary. And that means the captain needs to run through that brick wall. The captain better run through that brick wall because if you want them to run through the brick wall, the captain better lead the way. And so it is the same philosophy that really is indicative of being successful in sports and being successful in basketball, being successful in politics as well. And I tell some of my own peers, right? Some that have great personalities but can't seem to find their way, right? I said, sports did nothing but groom you. I said, you could go back to your own community and leverage what you've done in that community and use the knowledge that you have and do what I'm doing here. It's no different. It really is no different than that. It's saying drive, determination, and willing to put in the hard work and then being humble enough to say that I don't know it all, right? And so you take that, it's a good start. It's a very good start.
Okay. I have a question from Audley, who is an MBA student in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, at the University of Pennsylvania Wharton School of Business. Woo! And the question is, and he first begins his question by thanking you for sharing your insights with us tonight. And the question is, how have you been successful in negotiating community benefits for Warrensville from large corporations?
So I go into any negotiation really with one thought in mind, really. First, understanding the overall benefit of having a big corporation in the city, right? And what that economically brings back to the city, which I can use to put back out in safety services, EMS runs, street paving, things that people need every day that are going to be beneficial to this community. But I don't stop there. My next stop is, okay, if we're going to build something here, let's make sure that there's equal opportunity for all those out here building projects. So if I do any city project, I try to get at minimum a 35% inclusion rate on a construction project. But I do it because, one, if I don't do it, trust and believe me, it won't happen on its own, right? Because it is about leveraging your own powers and resources to make make economic opportunity for others evolve, right? The other thing it does is, we're talking about job creation. Is this going to be a facility where we can have locals work here for economic empowerment? It really is about the when I do a deal, and I'm sure he knows this, that being at Penn, it's the ecosystem that you build, right? Mm-hmm. It's the ecosystem that you build, and then they know that you're coming from a genuine space, right? I'm trying to make sure it's better for a lot of people, not just a few people, right? And those are the deals for me that I work the hardest on because I see the benefits for all. But trust and believe to the good question is that if you're not there stirring the waters, trying to make it happen, the chances of it happening on its own, I mean, slim, right? It's just not. Somebody's got to always be there to drive the table. And it's like, up. Now we're going off track. We got to come back here because everybody's got to win in the triangle deal here.
Okay. So we have another question from Reverend Heidi, a pastor in the greater Cleveland area. And Reverend Heidi wants to know, with everything we see erupting across the country, what programs does the city of Warrensville have in place to help the youth navigate the system to reach the level of success that you have achieved?
Well, so let me tell you, so Warrensville is unique. So the way the city is chartered, the city has no youth program. We have no rec. We don't, that's not under our auspice of the city. It's under the auspice of the school. So what I had to do when I took over was try to find partners out here to engage the youth. So we were responsible for acquiring land and sold land to the county library to do build the new county library, which now we run 8 million programs out of there. To make sure, and not only million programs, we make sure that we fund them so they can do some of the program that by charter and statute that I can't do. We mm-hmm. also did on the adjacent to the library, we built a facility, a building, and leased it really to the Greater Cleveland YMCA for the athletic and other, not just athletic and weight training, but the programming that can come there. To avail our community to other opportunities that didn't exist. And then lastly, we're always working hand in hand with Warrensville City Schools. Warrensville City Schools is now run by Superintendent Donald Jolly, who is a graduate of Warrensville like I. And we get together and we try to put together things, thinking and make sure things happen. A case in point in the schools, he and I went in on a partnership with Cleveland Clinic South Point create a aspiring doctors program. So we take kids from the 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th grade and fund them to go through a training program, aspiring doctors program, whether you want to be a doctor, EMS, the exposure. Mm-hmm. So for 4 years, they'll run through this program. We created a fire EMS program as well to train and give opportunity to young people who might want to pursue the fire profession as well. But mm-hmm. I believe in this. I believe in making sure we invest at that level so there's some benefit, tangible benefits that come back. And it's pretty much like I did. So if you throw a boomerang out there, you hope that's going to return, but you got to make sure the boomerang is built and constructed well to come back to you.
Absolutely. I've been very impressed myself with the work that you and my good friend and fraternity brother Donald Jolly have done in terms of trying to engage young people in Warrensville Heights, but not just engaging young people, but looking at the family and seeing the needs of the family. I have personally volunteered at Warrensville Heights High School on a Wednesday to pass out
food bank. Yep.
To make sure that folk in Warrensville Heights, in the midst of this pandemic situation, have food to eat. And so I know that Warrensville Heights is not just a city who is responding just strictly from a political perspective, you're responding from a practical perspective to the needs that people have and the things that folks are dealing with on a daily basis. And that's a great thing.
And let me say this, I believe, you know, because you have people on the masterclass call tonight from across the country, right? You know, the people here, and I'm no different than anybody. I should not be any different than any other person in any other city who is sitting in the place I am. The people in Warrensville, you know, I look out, they're my family. That's who they are, right? And I think of them like family, right? Mm-hmm. Now, you got some ones that literally need more maintenance than others, and some that need less maintenance, and then some that can coast it out pretty well. But when I'm thinking about the group. So Donald Jolly and I, we're always thinking about the group. We're thinking about how we can make it better for the group. So you can't take care of the kids without the parents, right? And so you got to create some opportunity for the parents too. And then you got to take some of the burden off the parents as well. Case in point, Pastor. Superintendent Jolly and I had a conversation and he went to pre-K here in Warrensville, right? They never had pre-K before. Opened it up pre-K because pre-K cost of child care can be expensive. Yes, it can, right? And if you're working a job and you are a 9-to-5 job, and you know, that's real money to real people. So when his school plan came out, they wanted to do a pre-K program here at no cost to the parent, right? Mm-hmm. That basically put money back in the parent's pocket, right? So it would help other things along the way. But we think in global matters like that, because they might have to do this out in some other suburban community, right? But the things that we have to do sometimes have to compensate and take into account some of the things that people don't talk about all the time, the needs that people have. Because people don't always come in and tell you what the problems are, what the needs are. So we have to do a lot of anticipation and anticipating out here in order to make things happen.
Well, I just want to take the time to say a special thank you to you for spending this time with us this evening. This has been, I'm sure, a very meaningful experience for all of our listeners who have come to be with us on this Zoom masterclass from all over the country. And we're just grateful to you for sharing and being so open with your time and with all of the gifts that God has given you and your generous spirit. And we thank God for you. I just want to take a moment and say thank you to our amazing sponsors, PNC Bank, Jumpstart, the Shin Family Foundation, as well as the Women of Color Foundation, the Mount Zion Congregational Church, United Church of Christ, because it is all of our sponsors who help to make these masterclasses possible in this season of pandemic and social upheaval in our country. It's important that we communicate with our people and let our community know that we are there to support you. And as co-chair of the Christian Business League, along with Joyce Shin, I'm grateful for the opportunity to be able to bring inspiration and information to all of those who join with us on all of our Christian Business League activities, events, and our sponsored programs, such as the Masterclass. And once again, a special thank you to Mayor Bradley D. Sellers, the great mayor of the city of Warrensville Heights, Ohio, a great leader in this region, because he's not just the mayor, but he's a leader in this region who is making his mark. And I can't wait to see what's next, because I know there's going to be something next. We'll be at the gym, and you're going to be telling me about a skyscraper that you're about to build in Warrensville, Ohio, the first one ever. And so I have no doubt that, as the Word of God says, that it doth not yet appear what you shall be. And so we look forward to the great things that you will do in Warrensville Heights in the years to come. We're excited because we do have another masterclass coming up in the month of December. We're excited about the fact that Robin Gordon, Director of Operations at NASA Glenn Research Center here in the greater Cleveland area, will be with us for a masterclass on December 4th at 7 p.m. And you don't want to miss Robin. She is a brilliant, brilliant scientist and a great, great leader who will give us insights on what it is like to be the director of operations of something as large as the NASA Glenn Research Center. She is the first woman to ascend to that position, the first African-American woman to ascend to that position. And we're so proud of her. And we look forward to joining with her on December 4th for our next masterclass. Again, thanks to Mayor Bradley Sellers. Thanks to all of our sponsors. And thanks to all of you for joining with us on this masterclass. We look forward to seeing you next time. God bless you and be safe.